What do you mean AJ's gone? Clementine exclaimed, frantically getting to her feet as fast as her swollen belly would allow. Louis stood with her, his hand on her lower back for support. Ten shuffled his feet awkwardly, the sun shone over on the roof floor, dust particles floating in midair. Before dinner, he said he wasn't hungry, so I let him use my coloring pencils, Ten explained, stepping back when he saw the fire in Clem's eyes light up. When I came back, he was gone, so I figured he'd come here instead. And you didn't think to come and check? Clementine asked, throwing her arms in the air. She felt the baby kick wildly, her anger masking the pain that she was feeling. I didn't think he'd run away, Ten defended himself. Health threw his eyes were downcast in shame. Louis stepped forward in between them, eyeing Clementine warily. Let's just cool off for a moment, he said. I'll go ask Violet and Asim to help me find him. He couldn't have gone far. You should stay here and rest. He directed a last part to Clem, who scoffed. The hell I'm resting, she exclaimed, already making her way to the door before she was stopped by Louis. Honey, Elnor already said you need to take it easy, he argued, and I'm worried about what will happen to the baby if you go trapezing through the woods in no direction when you could barely move without hurting. Let us handle it, and I promise you that AJ will be back home in no time. She huffed in annoyance, but agreed nonetheless. There was no reason for her to put herself in danger. Not of all the times reluctantly, she nodded and frowned. Louis and Ten out of the room. The trio rushed through the halls as fast as Clem could. On the way, they ran into Willy and Ruby, both of them who were frantically searching in some of the dorms. He's not here, Ruby called to Ten, who shook his head. I think he might have gone outside, he said. Louis burst through the courtyard doors, holding the door of them open for Clem, who waddled right through. Her hands drew circles on her belly as a way to calm herself down. He's fine, fine, Clementine, she kept telling herself, repeating it in her brain like a mantra. Louis rushed to where Violet and Sim sat on the tables. At the sight of them both stopped and they rushed towards him. Violet and held her meat cleaver in one hand, the compound bow unstrapped on her back. Ten told us what happened, Violet said immediately. We're coming with you, Asim piped in, nodding at Louis. Louis smiled at his friends, looking down at Clem. She was caressing her belly fiercely, her eyes darting away from the gate every few seconds. With the promising to bring AJ back, he leaned in and placed a kiss on his wife's lips. She wrapped her arms around his neck, pulling him closer to her. Please, she pleaded with tears in her eyes. Damn hormones, she thought ruefully. Come back safe. I will, he said, nodding. I promise. You stay here and let Ruby know if you need anything. With that said, the trio made their way out of the gate, where Willy was waiting for them. He opened it and wished them good luck as before they stopped once again by Minnie rushing at Violet. She wrapped her arms around her girlfriend tightly, pulling back and placing a soft kiss on her lips. Good luck, she whispered to Violet, who couldn't hide her blush from creeping up on her face. Glancing at Louis and Asim when they smirked, she pushed them past and walked into the woods. The two men at her heels, Louis brandished Charles and its wooden surface resting on his right shoulder. The birds were singing at the beginning of the new day. Dried up leaves have crunched over the weight of his boots as they walked through the forest. About 20 minutes later, after not seeing any trace of the boy, they decided that splitting up was their best. As Sim went off towards the east, Violet bounding to the west, Louis took a deep breath and ventured deeper in the southern parts of the woods. He could hear the faint grumbling of distant walkers prowling for prey. Shuddering, drained slightly, he walked over forward, looking around. Although he did thought he saw thousands of them in the woods, never ceased to creep the men out this early in the morning. Everything was starting to wake from its slumber, coming to life as the sun made its way through the sky. He passed a fallen tree, its bark was splashed with dry blood, and he noticed. Weird, he thought, frowning. He then heard a loud growl to his left and he turned. A walker was strapped under a large tree branch, its arms flailing out in reach of Louis. He hunched over and as he neared it, he noticed the puncture marks on his shirt, dry blood staining the white fabric. These are just recent, he breathed. Even spurturing the marks, AJ may have gone this way, he thought to himself. Before he could delve any further into his fury, he heard a scream coming from his left. A Sim! He stood up in a hurry, jumping over the fallen tree and sprinting for the woods. As a soft breeze picked up, the leaves above him rustled, the sound of it almost drowning his thoughts. He rushed past a small bridge and ran over the river and saw the source of the scream. A Sim was struggling with a walker on the far side of the ramshack in his hut. Its deathly grips drawn on his forearm. A Sim's bow had been lying on the ground a few feet away from him, and the walker was crawling towards him from the edge of the river. Lewis! He cried. He spotted the freckled man, and his eyes were filled with fear. Springing into action, Lewis took care of the crawler first, stomping its head with the sole of his boot. He used Charles to dispatch the other walker that gripped onto SM's arm, crushing his skull with a sickening crunch. As its grasp on his arm was loosened, SM landed on his butt and on the ground, breathing heavily. Lewis offered his hand to the man, who took it graciously, and he dusted himself off, attempting to control his breathing. "Thanks, man," he said, nodding at Lewis. "No problem," Lewis replied with a lopsided grin. "Wouldn't want you dying before you get married. Reed, what will I tell Ruby?" "Don't joke about that, man." "Sorry," he said sheepishly. Lewis looked around, noticing that the first time they were gone, he set Charles against the wall of the hut and raised an eyebrow. "Why are you at the fishing hut?" A Sim picked up his bow and strapped it onto his back. "I remember AJ said something about fishing to me last night, and I thought maybe he had come here." Lewis frowned, unable to recall such a comment from the young boy, and he did specify about this place. "Not that I remember," Asim said, shrugging. "But we're here. Where else will we be referring to?" Lewis racked his brain for clues, thinking about the recent interactions with AJ with his recollection. The boy hadn't mentioned anything about going fishing. It had always been his least favorite chore. His least favorite chore. While at the school, suddenly a specific memory flashed before his eyes, something that had happened 5 years ago, quite a long way from his particular fishing hut. He grabbed Charles and looked up at the sky. It was a beautiful blue by now, streaks of yellow from the sun shining through it. He got his bearings and he turned to a Sim, who was staring at him like crazy. "I know where he is," he announced, nodding. "How?" "I just know," he promised. "Go back and let Clem know I got it. And find Vi, too. No need to have her looking around for no reason." "Are you just going to tell me where AJ is?" a Sim asked, irritated by now. "Just trust me, okay?" Lewis asked. A Sim rolled his eyes and nodded. "All right, I'll go tell Clem," he promised, adjusting his bow. "You both better come back safe." "We will." With that, Lewis bounded off into the forest. He kept on the sun on his left, avoiding the places where the groans and moans by nearby walkers could be heard by the loudest. He had been walking for about a half an hour when he reached what seemed to be looking for. A barbed fence ran around the length of the yard, stelps of tall grass covering in most of it. A mangled corpse was trapped between the two of the wires, its body slashed in the same manner as the other one he found earlier. A deep bloody hole adorned with its forehead and its mouth agape. He used Charles to lift up the barbed wire and slip through it. He slowly made his way for the grass, using his hunting knife to cut for the longest ones so he can have a better view. After a few minutes, he stepped into the gravel path. In front of him was a large lake, extending as far as eye can see. On the other side of the bank was orange leaves on the trees, reflected on the crystalline surface. All a small shack stood at the edge of the yard, its windows at the door and the door destroyed years ago. Half of the roof had collapsed on itself from the last time he'd been there, a wooden beam sticking out of the bit. There was a small pier that housed a single lonely wooden boat. Its soars where it's completely gone, but its wood was still intact. A bit somewhat rotten inside of the boat was AJ, facing the water and giving his back to Lewis. Lewis sighed at the sight, walking slowly forward. When he was a short distance away from the boy, he stepped out and put his hands in his pockets. "Hey, buddy," he said, startling AJ. The boy turned around to the spot and stared at Lewis. He had a look of a shock present on his face. "Lewis, how did you find me?" "I'm an amazing detective," Lewis claimed, promptly grabbing the flaps of his drenched coat. AJ turned back to the water and sighed. "Sure, Lewis. Frowning, the freckled man stepped onto the boat and sat beside AJ, and it rocked a bit in the shallow water, creating ripples on its pristine surface. Lewis wondered how it managed to stay clean after all these years, but focused on more in the pressing matter. "What's on your mind, AJ?" he whispered, placing a hand on the boy's shoulder. Thankfully, he did not shake the hand off. "Lewis, do you love me?" Taking back a question, Lewis smiled. "Of course I love you, little dude," he said. "You're my family. Remember the last time we were here?" AJ asked, looking over at the horizon. "You told me the exact same thing over there." He pointed somewhere in the middle of the lake, where the water deepened and its blue hue became darker. "Oh, I do remember that," said Lewis. "That's how I found you, actually." "I want to believe that, Lewis," said AJ, "but lately it feels that you and Clem love the baby more than me. Like you don't want to be with me anymore."
"Well, what gave you that idea?"
"Well, not at first, but I have a feeling you guys were pushing me away," AJ attempted to explain, frowning at the grasp of the words. "It's like the baby is taking my place."
"The baby is not going to do such thing, kiddo," Lewis assured him. "Having a baby will not change how Clem and I feel about you. It just means that there's going to be even more love to go around."
AJ pierced his lips and, looking up at his father figure, he had been the only one he ever known. He cast his eyes down to his hands, shaking his head.
"But you guys are like a different kind of family, you know? Clem always felt like a mom to be for me, but I always never knew she wasn't really my mom. I never met my mom and dad. Clem told me stories about them, but she didn't know them for long either. I never really had a real father. This baby won't feel that. He or she will have two real parents."
"Well, yeah, we will be related by blood, but that doesn't make you any less important. Listen, I had a biological father, and he was a grade 8 a-hole."
"He was?" AJ asked.
"Yeah, I hated him my entire life. He's the reason why I was sent to this school in the first place."
"What I'm trying to say is that having a real father isn't what defines your values as a person. It's just what you think of yourself that matters."
The boy looked down on the floor of the boat and pensively, absently kicking the small pebble that had lodged itself in between two planks. Lewis placed a hand on AJ's shoulder, smiling down at his adoptive son. "AJ, we love you so much, and I know when that baby comes, you'll be the best big brother anyone could ever ask for. All it takes is a little confidence in yourself, I promise you. You'll never be cast aside, not by me, and especially not by Clementine. You'll always be her little goofball."
AJ smiled when he thought, looking up at Lewis. "You really mean that?"
"Hell yeah, little man," he exclaimed, clapping the boy's shoulder. "You remember the first time we came here? You asked me and Clem if I were having a baby?"
"I did?"
"Yep."
"I was shocked," Lewis said, nodding. He looked up at the sun, which had been already high above them, warming the otherwise chilly atmosphere. "I think we should get going now. Clem must be worried sick."
"Yeah," AJ replied, getting off the boat and walking towards the overgrown yard. He looked back at Lewis and with a sad smile.
"Oh, and Lewis?"
"Yes?"
"I'm sorry I ran off." "Don't sweat it, little man. Just try not to do that again, okay?"
The pair made their way through the tall grass, reaching the barbed wire and slipping through it with some effort. As they made their way back to the school, AJ suggested they play plant spotting, which brought a smile to Lewis's face. For the next half hour, they pointed out an exotic plants along the way, grading each other on how cool they looked. A rather beautiful yellow daffodil with orange streaks earned Lewis's perfect score, while AJ was the only one who got 8, and he caught a glimpse of a white rose with dark red stains. The boy claimed that they were natural streaks, while Lewis argued that it was just some walker's blood. At the end, he let AJ have it and reward them a 10, efforting it to play the game. When they reached the school, Lewis pulled AJ aside and kneeled down in front of him. "Now I want you to apologize to Clem, okay?"
"Yeah, I'll do it," AJ said, nodding.
"Let's just hope she doesn't kill you," Lewis teased.
"She wouldn't do that."
"You're right," Lewis said. "I forgot you have some sort of humanity to her anger." AJ giggled as they pushed through the gates of the school open, surprised that no one was there to greet them. They spotted Violet stepping out of the admin mid-building in a rush. When her eyes landed on Lewis, she rushed to them, offering a curious smile to AJ.
"Glad you're back, kiddo," she said, breathing her rabid rage.
Lewis frowned and looked down. down at his friend. Friend raised an eyebrow. Vi, what's wrong? He asked. Walker attack or something? God, I hope not. No, Lou, she said rather perturbably. It's Clementine. What is it? Louis's tone dropped at the mention of his wife, horrible thoughts swimming through his mind. The baby's coming.